You're at 2780 Reamanville Avenue, Ferndale, Michigan.
For the fact that getting the vaccine makes sense, the benefit outweighs the risk.
So let's talk a little bit about that, because I think that that's a really, really important point that you just made, and I want to kind of unpack that a little slower. So explain that again. When you are looking at what the risks are basically of severe COVID in children compared to the risks of the vaccine, the argument is still compelling. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly right. If you look at the numbers and the mathematical models, and again, this is available on the CDC website, when the recent advisory committee for immunization practices met to take a look at the safety signal of cases of myocarditis after the vaccine, there was some fairly impressive mathematical modeling that looked at the number of cases of myocarditis that a vaccine would prevent, as opposed to the vaccine that would be a result of the vaccine. So in other words, because there's a certain number of children after getting COVID infection itself will have heart problems afterwards, the numbers bear out that it is a benefit to get the vaccine, that it will prevent, the vaccine will prevent more heart infections like myocarditis than the vaccine would cause. If that explanation makes any sense. I know that logic is a little bit windy, it can be a little bit hard to follow, but it is much less than would be if a patient got severe COVID-19 infection. It prevents those cases.
You know, and I think it's just, you probably can't say that enough. And one of the reasons that I kind of think why, and again, I'm just thinking in my own mind back to that conversation I was having with a group of parents yesterday, is that when we were talking about the heart effects of COVID months ago, we were talking about MISC. And MISC was on the lips of every parent, but maybe not realizing that what we were talking about at that point included myocarditis.
Yes.
So sometimes, you know, now the word myocarditis is on everyone's lips because we've been talking about that as a unique rare side effect of the vaccine. And there's not necessarily that connection made that MISC also included myocarditis, which is why I'm so grateful actually that we had this caller. The first question of the day, was asking about the heart side effects of the virus, right? Because there are heart side effects of the virus, and we are, as pediatricians, being careful about who we can say can return to sports after they've had a severe infection with COVID, because there are heart side effects from the virus itself. So I think that's a really just important point to make, and not a connection that's necessarily made in others, in part because we were using different terminology. So I don't know that is a connection that people are making.
Yeah, agree with you. I think it is important. And it's important to just be aware of the numbers and that oftentimes it isn't an either or, but it is kind of misunderstanding, I guess, and managing the risk.
Yes.
And that's a hard concept, I think, to get comfortable with.
Yes, no, I couldn't agree with you more. Well, let's just, for our audience, talk a little bit about what we have seen with the vaccine, if you don't mind, just what the rare side effects are, what the rates are, and what we started noticing, and if you can just kind of tell us a little bit more about that, I think that would be illuminating.
Yeah, you know, the good news for kids is that I think by and large, the 12 and ups who have already had the vaccine, the majority of them are really doing very well. And the vaccine, the side effect, the profile is very similar to what we see with adults. So kids who are complaining of sore arm, who are complaining of some fatigue and muscle, like maybe some low grade fever, that profile looks very, very similar to what adults have seen. The good news for kids is that anaphylaxis or allergic reaction, very, very rare, again, similar to adults as well. And then and then this myocarditis that we're seeing, males more than females, and in the adolescent and young adult male population.
I know you've already explained that myocarditis is an inflammation of the heart, of the heart muscle. Can you tell our audience a little bit about what the symptoms of that would be, if anyone is listening and thinking, you know, did this happen to my child? How would I know?
Yeah, great question. I think this is an important one to go over. So primarily the presenting symptom of young people who have myocarditis, overwhelmingly it's chest pain. I complain of chest pain. There can be shortness of breath associated. For some, there's fever and muscle aches as well. But chest pain seems to be the primary thing. And the signal has been in a temporary or time relation to the second dose of the vaccine is generally in the kind of 3, 4, 5 days with the incident. even some of the wildly implausible sounding theories or explanations or concerns that we have all seen circulating that have been categorically debunked, I think it's still appropriate to listen and come from the perspective of empathy and concern, as opposed to, oh my gosh, that's just the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. Even though I know that there have been, you know, there are lots of reactions like that when some of these things get out there online. So it's listening, it's really understanding what is, trying to get to the bottom of what is really the concern. Is really the concern that it is a freedom issue? Is it I don't understand the science issue? What does it boil down to? And then trying to meet them where they are has really been the way that's been my stepwise approach that has worked so far.
Well, what I would like to do, if it's possible, is I'm going to share with you some of the common concerns that I've heard in my practice, and I would like to just talk about them because I think it's important for our audience. We've certainly, over the course of the last couple of months, had certainly a lot of callers with some of these exact questions, so I'm going to ask you some of them, but before I do, I just wanted to remind our listeners that you too could join this very interesting conversation about COVID vaccines in children. You can call us at 877-NYU-DOT, that's 877-698-3627, or you can email your questions to us at docs@SiriusXM.com. I'm Dr. Seema Awashramani, and I'm joined by Dr. Christina Johns this morning, and we're continuing to talk about this very important subject. So, Dr. Johns, let's start with the one of the questions that I get very frequently, which is that if COVID is so, does not cause significant side effects in children, why should we be even accepting any potential risk from a vaccine?
That's a common one that I get too, and the numbers make that, I think, fairly easy to answer. I think we need to keep in mind that there are so far over 4,000 children who have gotten MISC, that post-infectious inflammatory condition that affects children who have had COVID-19. 4,000, that's a bigger number than I think I even initially thought when I heard it. And so that is something that, look, if you don't get COVID-19, you don't get MISC. And so that right there is one reason that I think it's important to include kids in the vaccine equation. Another is that we are starting to see, we need to learn more about this, but we are starting to see a growing percentage of children who have long hauler symptoms. And we don't know the full depth and breadth of that situation yet, and what those symptoms mean for the long term. But for younger children who should have a whole lifetime ahead of them, it seems like it would be very, very prudent then, again, thinking in that risk-benefit frame of mind, to do what we can to prevent them from getting any chance of potentially having long hauler symptoms. So I think that certainly from an individual basis about kids in particular, leaving aside all of the herd immunity, and boy, do we want to get back to normal at the end of the pandemic, there are lots of individual reasons to protect children.
Yes. And I think, look, the other reason, you're right, I mean, those are the reasons for the individual child, but people also have, you know, other vulnerable people living in their households too. You can't stop the disease until we get to a point that many people are vaccinated.
Yeah, without a doubt.
What about the concerns? If you hear people say, again, I hear people say this, that this isn't studied, and we don't have adequate information about the vaccine.
I think that there are a number of ways to approach that question. I think that many times, at least in my experience, that has been folded up into, wow, this, you know, how could they have, you know, developed this so fast and studied this and evaluated it in such a short amount of time. And I think that it is important to say out loud a couple of things. Number one, that mRNA technology is not new, that it is something that has been used before, so it wasn't as if the situation where that we had to spend a bunch of time in a lab creating the technology that was already in existence. And I think that it's also important to remember that during the pandemic, there was a worldwide effort to recruit patients, right? Usually when there is a research study, voluntary participants and human subjects in a research study, the patient recruitment phase of the study actually takes a quite a long time. And in this situation, because it was a worldwide pandemic, there were people coming out of the woodwork, which is wonderful, to volunteer to be part of the research. And so we were able to amass the appropriate number of participants to statistically power the results appropriately to see a significant difference between the two study groups in a very short amount of time. So while it may seem like it was a short amount of time to develop and get this vaccine out there, all of the appropriate steps were taken. And I think, you know, I know many said that early on, perhaps we need to kind of revisit that to remind people of that. And in addition, now that we have seen slightly less time in the pediatric population, of course, but in the adult population, so many millions of people have gotten the vaccine and have done quite well. Important to call out historically that any long-term, any negative effects or significant negative effects from a vaccine that can be attributed to a vaccine occur within about 6 weeks or so after the time of vaccine administration. In all of the history of vaccines, we don't have conditions that surface 5 years, 10 years later that we say, oh, yeah, well, that was due to this particular vaccine. That hasn't happened, and there's no reason, given this technology, there's no reason to think that it would happen here too.
I think that is a good one. In fact, that was going to be my next question to you, is that I certainly hear people say, well, how will you know there's no long-term side effects because we haven't observed this vaccine for a really long time? So thank you for addressing that one too. We have an email from Sharon. So Sharon is asking, she's from San Diego. She says, when will we start vaccinating for two and up? And also, can we let, my producer is telling me this is a caller. Is that right? Sharon, are you with us? I'm sorry. Nope. Perhaps not. Sorry. I'm going to go ahead and read. Sharon, are you there? Dr. Jones, I think, it, you know, to your one of the first how employer asks you the question, you know, when we talk about the risk of having COVID versus the risk of the vaccine, how do you think the Delta variant will impact what we perceive to be the risk of severe illness in children with COVID? My feeling is that risk is only going to go up.
Yeah, you know, I think it's really hard, I think, to give a definitive data-driven answer to that question right now because it's too early in the game. But I do think that because it is a more transmissible a virus, it means that there will be more kids who, because they are the vulnerable population right now, because they don't have the vaccine yet, there will be more kids who will ultimately get a more highly transmissible variant. That's just basic math there. And when you have more kids who are getting the virus, period, that means that there will likely be a higher percentage of children getting more severe disease. It doesn't necessarily mean that the variant itself is causing more severe disease, although I think that in adults there is some data right now, in pediatrics there are some reports that may be the case, but it may be a sheer numbers thing, that because we have more people, more kids who are getting the virus, that if the proportions bear out, that we may see more with severe illness. Is that your vibe as well?
Yes, I think so. That's my feeling. And you're right. It's not. We still need more data about how the Delta variant affects severe illness in kids. But I fear that it being more transmissible will mean that those numbers will go up, because we'll see. Well, we're going to see more cases, unfortunately, I think, coming
yeah.
soon.
Yeah. Agreed.
We are going to actually take, if it's okay with you, Dr. Johns, a short break. And when we come back, we are going to talk a little bit more about vaccines, perhaps, but also talk about how kids will re-enter this new normal, if you will. If there are callers who still wish to ask us questions about vaccines, keep your phone lines ready. We're happy to continue to take your calls. In fact, you can use the break to do that. You can call 877-NYU-DOCS, and we will take your calls on the other side. See you in a moment.